vote.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Rustin.
Thank you, Madam Acting Deputy President. And I just feel the need to defend my Tasmanian colleagues in the face of that outburst about suggesting that the Tasmanian senators and members of the lower house have not been out there and talking up the important aspects of the federal budget and also federal policy positions that are now being implemented that were promised at the federal election in 2013. And certainly I have heard many times senators in this place from Tasmania and the three members of the lower house out there talking up the importance of Tasmania and the support that they give their home state. So I'd just like to put it on the record that unless Senator Brown has got a hearing problem, maybe she should listen a little more in her home state about her colleagues, even if they are from the other side of the chamber, and the support that they give their home state. Before I go to the substance of what I'd like to say today in relation to the matter of public importance in relation to the Prime Minister's election commitments, can I just also draw to the attention of the House the extraordinary scaremongering that continues to go on? And you know, you talk about the ABC fact check. Maybe we need a fact check in this place, because some of the things that have been sent while I've sat here and listened to the contribution of those opposite, it just astounds me that factually incorrect. Not just they haven't heard, but they actually make statements that are factually incorrect. And those statements are actually and the scaremongering that's going on are actually creating a very negative and uncertain environment out there amongst the voters, and it's really not fair. If there are hard messages to sell, let's be honest about them and tell them the truth. Don't beat up with a whole heap of scaremongering. But I'd just like to draw an interesting comparison between the federal government, with a federal coalition government, and a current Labor government that's actually in existence in this country, and that's the state Labor government in South Australia, who have been in power in South Australia for the last 12 years. And in that time, we've seen South Australia become somewhat of a laughing stock for the rest of the country in the fact that we have an environment that doesn't encourage business, it doesn't support business growth, and we are the highest taxed state, we're the state with the highest debt. And so it's really quite interesting to draw a parallel between what's happening federally and the positive things that, that we are trying to put in place despite the resistance and blocking that we receive in the Senate for trying to get some of the initiatives that we took to the election campaign through this place, and despite the people of Australia having voted for this government exactly on those mandates. But I just draw to the House's attention that the South Australian Labor government is a classic example of what happens when you do extraordinary things with budgets, and that's exactly what we inherited when we came into government in 2013. Currently in South Australia, the 2012-13 budget deficit was $940 million. That's the highest on record, and when you consider the population of South Australia on a pro rata basis, it is an extraordinary amount of money that is owed by every man, woman and child in South Australia to pay for the budget deficit in South Australia. It's delivered budget deficits for the past 4 years. And over the past year, the projected deficit has blown out to be $1.2 billion, the largest budget deficit in over 15 years. But the really annoying thing and the dishonest thing and the unscrupulous thing that's going on at the moment is that the Wetherill Labor government in South Australia is trying to con the South Australian public into thinking this is all the federal government's fault. Well, I just have to put on the record that the $14 billion debt bill that was projected by the Wetherill government out to 2016 was on the books well before we were elected to government in 2013, Madam Acting Deputy President. So it seems a little bit rich that we have a situation at the moment where the Wetherill government is spending millions of dollars of South Australia's taxpayers' money—well, it's actually not South Australian taxpayers' money, because they've probably had to borrow it like they borrow everything else to spend in South Australia. To actually fund a campaign to blame the federal government for something that, if you actually look at their budget figures, they acknowledged well before the Abbott government was elected to this place, actually was already in existence. But worse than the budget deficit in South Australia is the election promises that the South Australian government made to the South Australian public about the creation of 100,000 jobs. We've seen in the time that they've been in government and their new creation of 100,000 jobs policy, we've seen 8,700 more jobs. 8,700, not 100,000. So I think we need to be very careful that we actually get the facts on the table here. And as those opposite have mentioned in relation particularly to education and health, and Mr Wetherill's out there and he's trying to make the suggestion that the federal government are cutting health and cutting education. And as we well know, Madam Acting Deputy President, as you would well know as you sat in the education hearings in relation to higher education and you sit on the Education Standing Committee, we know that education funding has not been cut. And I repeat, education funding has not been cut. So for Mr Wetherill to be somehow blaming the federal government for cuts in funding that are going to South Australia, when in fact the amount of money that's going to South Australia, not just for education but also for health, is increasing, makes his lie and his deceits even worse. The fact is the South Australian government have created their own debt and deficit problem. The blame lies firmly with their policies and the implementation of their policies, and it seems extraordinarily rich that, that he would suggest to blame us and then to spend additional money in creating a false campaign. And you know, you don't actually have to entirely take my word for this. In fact, this morning in the paper, thank you, Senator Payne, she was going to take my word for it. This morning in the paper, there is a letter that has been revealed from the Essential Services Commission in South Australia, ESCOSA, which is actually the independent economic regulator in South Australia. And the chief executive of this regulator, Dr Paul Kerrin, who had been appointed by the previous Labor government to this position, resigned the week following the South Australian election. And Mr Kerrin, in his letter, actually states, "I have voted Labor most of my life and I chose to join the commission under a Labor government. However, having seen that government from the inside, I have no appetite to deal with it for another 4 years." Mr Kerrin then goes on to say, in relation to the reforms and the regulator, his oversight of particular agencies in South Australia, you know, undergoing the, you know, the water industry's economic reform, you know, the commission's role in driving that reform, the independence of government, you know, government legislation, etc. His comments were, "My experience over the past 3 years has shown that the understanding in relation to those economic activities was incorrect. Instead, the government and its senior bureaucrats have clearly demonstrated that they have no interest in genuine reform nor in serving the long-term interests of consumers. Indeed, they have stymied all efforts on those fronts at every turn. Further, I have also been appalled by the behaviour that both ministers and senior bureaucrats have engaged in to stymie those efforts." Now, you would have to suggest that if you were going to appoint somebody to be an economic regulator and you were completely convinced of the goodness and the well-being that you were providing to your state and the economic development you were providing to your state by your policies, Madam Acting Deputy President, you would certainly think that you would give your economic regulator every opportunity to be able to better those policies, keep an eye on them and make sure that they really were delivering the things that you were saying. It appears to me from the comments made by Dr Kerrin, which were revealed only after a Freedom of Information request, because the bureaucrats within the department actually refused to release this letter of resignation from Dr Kerrin, citing that it was contrary to the public interest, which I thought was quite an interesting reason for not releasing the fact that somebody was being critical of the operation of the government. But you would actually think that the South Australian government would have wanted a level of transparency around its economic regulator, because surely if everything that they are saying about the economic prosperity and all the great things that they are doing in South Australia, they would want the independent verification of their independent regulator. So, Madam Acting Deputy President, I think that's a very sad indictment of one of Australia's Labor governments, and probably is a precursor to what eventually and hopefully shortly the South Australian government, when it changes hands, is probably going to be, with the federal government, maybe an indication of what the Liberal Party in South Australia is likely to inherit if and when they should win government in South Australia. So, in standing here today talking on this matter of public interest, I'd just like to put on the record that I think it's abhorrent that we are conducting scaremongering without any real facts around the information that we're putting into the public domain.
Thank you, Senator Rustin.